Being diagnosed with cancer is devastating, but when you're one of the lucky ones that manages to survive and get to NED or having no evidence of the disease, you're all good and back to normal, right? Probably not. In this video, I'm going to talk about all the ways that cancer has permanently changed my life. But first, let me introduce myself to any newbies out there. My name is Jelena. And I was diagnosed with stage 3 colorectal cancer, more specifically rectal cancer, in 2016, just days before my 35th birthday. I had no family history of cancer and was an otherwise healthy and active person, so my diagnosis hit me like a ton of bricks. Hit the like button below here if you're ready to hear about all the ways that cancer has permanently changed my life. Before I dive into these changes, I think it's important for me to give you a quick summary of the 5 major parts of treatment that I went through, because each of those parts has contributed to these permanent changes in my body. The first 2 major parts happened at the same time, and it was 28 days of the oral chemotherapy Xeloda and 28 days of pelvic radiation. Next up was LAR surgery, also known as a lower anterior resection. During that surgery, I had 12 inches of my colon and rectum removed, 17 lymph nodes were removed, and I had an ileostomy created. A quick summary of the ileostomy, it's where your small intestine is routed out your abdominal wall and your waste exits your body through that into a bag that you wear instead of out your butt. Then I went through 8 rounds of the IV chemotherapy FOLFOX, and to finish everything up, I had that ileostomy reversed. If you're unsure of some of that or want more details on that, I've got the playlist right up here so you can go through what treatment was like. But make sure you come back here if you click on that. Now that you know what my body endured during treatment, let's talk about the changes all those things caused. First, let me talk about the obvious physical changes. The most prominent ones are my scars. Let me give you a tour. So I have this long scar down the middle of my abdomen from my LAR surgery. Goes straight through my belly button, so that's nice and deformed now. I've got 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, there's 2 scars there, one of them is from the surgery, 5, 6 of these little holes where the trocars were inserted into me, and then plenty of little scars you can see close here where the staples were to staple everything shut. In case you're unfamiliar with what a trocar is, here's a picture of them. They're used to provide access into your abdomen for surgery. There is also this large scar here where my ileostomy was and got shoved back into me. And this ugly looking scar from where my port was. And here's a picture of the port that I had. They used that to do blood draws for me, and also I received my chemotherapy through that instead of through an IV in my arm. The ileostomy wound was left open to close on its own, and my port incision, it was glued shut both times that it was opened for insertion and removal. So that's why there aren't any staple holes, scars, around either of those. One last one that's not quite as obvious as the scars is that my hair has a little bit more of a beachy wave vibe to it. I don't know if you're really getting it too much today, but it was poker straight before cancer. So having even a little bit of a wave is a big difference from my hair before. Next up, the changes that the average person would never see or even notice. As soon as I started radiation and the oral chemotherapy, my period stopped. My OBGYN, however, wouldn't officially diagnose me as being in menopause until 6 months after I completed treatment. I didn't really notice any menopause symptoms, other than not having a period, until after my ileostomy reversal surgery, which was my final step in treatment. About a month after the surgery, I started having hot flashes all the time. With menopause also comes vaginal dryness and a decreased sex drive, both of which I also deal with. I was put on hormone replacement therapy to help these symptoms and also to help prevent osteoporosis and heart disease. And so far, it looks like it's just helping to eliminate the hot flashes, and prevent heart disease. I just mentioned that I was put on hormone replacement therapy to help prevent osteoporosis, but I think it's only partially worked. My general practitioner has been super proactive in watching me for everything since my cancer diagnosis. So in the fall of 2020, she sent me in to get a bone scan. Well, it's a good thing she did, because it turns out that I have osteopenia in my spine, which means that I have bone loss, but it's not quite osteoporosis yet, but it's definitely worse than it should be for someone in their late 30s. As a result, I now take a calcium supplement daily to hopefully stop the bone loss from continuing and maybe even to repair it a little bit. Since my cancer was bowel-related, it only makes sense that I have bathroom issues. Also, it turns out that having your waste routed out your stomach through your small intestine for a few months and then reversing it and putting everything back together can mess with your digestion for years to come. I take Metamucil daily to bulk up my stools because without it, and even sometimes with it, it just comes out as fluffy pieces multiple times a day. I also have Imodium on standby and take it as needed. I can't eat lentils much, black beans and chickpeas cause me problems, and lettuce, it just likes to go straight through me and comes back out undigested. Just to name a few things that cause me digestion problems. Some days, I'll only pass 1 to 2 bowel movements. Other days, once I get to 4 or 5, I've had enough and I'll take some Imodium to slow things down. Bowel movements don't come out all at once either, even when it's just the fluffy pieces. I have to sit on the toilet for at least 15 to 20 minutes waiting for multiple rounds of stool to come out. If I don't hang out on the toilet, then I have to go to the bathroom 5 minutes later over and over and over again to let everything out. In addition to the bowel movement changes, I also suffer from excessive gas. My husband likes to call them surgically enhanced farts, since I had surgery on my colon, but not specifically to change my farts. The gas smells really bad all the time, and it's never just one fart. Once it starts, it goes for like an hour or so at least. Most of the time they're quiet, so they really can be called silent but deadly. GasX only takes the edge off a little bit, but it doesn't get rid of the gas completely. I've only recently attempted to try and figure out if there is any correlation between the foods that I eat and the excessive gas, and the only thing that I've come up with so far is that plain Greek yogurt definitely increases my gas. I don't have the major fatigue that I had when I was on chemotherapy, but gone are the days when I can get by with just 5 to 6 hours of sleep at night. I have to have 7 to 8, otherwise by 10 a.m. I'm falling asleep. I occasionally can get by with 6 hours, but most of the time I end up falling asleep for an hour or two to make it through the day. And having a nap is not a usual thing for me. I never napped pre-cancer. I had great teeth before cancer. I've only ever had 1 or 2 cavities, and when I go in every 6 months for my teeth to get cleaned, the dentist always compliments me on how nice my teeth are. But once treatment finished, I noticed my teeth had gotten a lot more sensitive. I couldn't drink from a glass that had ice in it unless I had a straw. And even then, sometimes when the cold would hit my teeth, it'd be sharp stabbing pains. The only way I could eat ice cream is if I took little small spoonfuls and stuck them on my tongue for my tongue to melt and warm it up. If any came off of my tongue while it was warming up, it was bad news. I tried sensitive toothpastes at the store, but they didn't help. So now I have to use a specially prescribed toothpaste from my dentist. Thankfully, it actually works, so I can drink cold beverages and enjoy ice cream again. This one is the most noticeable when I'm typing or when I'm trying to play my violin. When I'm typing, I make a lot more errors now because I find my fingers are a lot more clumsy. And when I'm playing my violin, it can be difficult and sometimes downright impossible for me to play some of the faster note patterns. I also can only play for about 45 minutes or so before my fingers hurt so much that I just can't play anymore. Then I have to wait at least 2 days before I can play again, because the next day if I try, my fingertips, they still hurt way too much to be able to play. Getting a cancer diagnosis, especially when you're young, most likely will change your outlook on life. It definitely did for me. I have more of a carpe diem or YOLO mindset to doing things now and not putting them off. That's why I went skydiving this year for my 40th birthday, ran the Pikes Peak Ascent this summer, and even partially why I started this YouTube channel. I want to do all I can to live the rest of my life to the fullest, whether I live one more year or 60 more years. I like to think that I don't suffer from chemo brain, but occasionally things will happen that make me think that I suffer from it a little bit. There have been many times where I've supposedly said something or had an entire conversation with a person and I don't remember it at all. Not just a little, oh, I don't remember what exactly we were talking about slip, but I truly don't remember having this conversation with somebody, but another person witnessed me talking to that person, so it had to have happened. It thankfully doesn't happen often, but as you can imagine, it's a bit frustrating when it does. Before my cancer diagnosis, I never dealt with any mental health issues. I made it through treatment, no troubles. But once things calmed down after treatment was over, I started having issues. Big issues. Like, I was having daily panic attacks where my heart and my mind were racing, the back of my head and neck, and sometimes even my face were going numb. I went to therapy, I took medications, I started doing daily meditations, and I even created this channel so that I could talk through the trauma that I had been through during my cancer treatment and not let it fester inside of me. I still listen to a meditation nightly, but I am off the daily medications and I'm not seeing the therapist anymore. Because after the first three or so sessions I had with her, I didn't really feel like I was getting anything out of it, and she was just kind of so-so. So there you have it. The old phrase, you can't judge a book by its cover, definitely applies to me. I may look normal, but there is a lot going on behind the scenes that I'm dealing with daily. I've pretty much learned to deal with these changes though, and try not to let them rule my life. I'm still active, I travel, and I plan to be prepared anytime I'm eating something that I know likes to just rocket straight through my digestive system. To hear more details on what exactly it was like to go through each part of my cancer treatment, you can click on the playlist up here. Or this video down here YouTube thinks you'd really like from my channel. Thanks for watching.